Good morning, friends. This is my continuation of Admission Deed 154th video. Now, very quickly, I'll rebrush what I had said earlier, that where in section 43 of the CLA rules in 1937, it clearly says when an old grant certificate terms is not forthcoming and in the absence of any definite proof, to the contrary, the presumption held on the terms of old grant. So, it cannot be asked. Now, similar thing has been reproduced in Imperial Gazetteer of 1909. There is no such thing as old grant. However, all revenue assignments made by Indian rulers to landowners were referred and called new grants. And they were issued new certificates on the legislation of the Government Grants Act 15 of 1895, referred Cantonment Act 1889. This is written in the Cantonment Act, law edition of 1986, J.P. Mittal. So, you know, we need to, why I read this quickly, old grant, and I'm again trying to bring you, it's good that we are called old grant, but we were supposed to be converted. And where is all this written and how it is to be drafted? In your pleadings is very important. So this question of admission deed continues. Now, where is this written? You know, the department letter number so-and-so 8249 dated 21st August 1970. It clearly flouts the DG and, you know, everybody's central rules. It says, son, you will not be given permission or you will not be mutated if you do not bloody sign an admission deed. So, the department has very clearly stipulated its executives under this section 34 on page 776, chapter 24. No property to be transferred till transferee admits government title on land, over land. So, these are executive orders. Why is it needed when it was written in the GGO, when it was written in the section 43 of the CLA rules? Now, another Government of India Ministry of Defence letter, number 2436, dated 29th March 1978. These all are contrary to the section 43 of the CLA rules, which I have said. No sanction shall be given where it appears that government claims to be proprietary rights in the site is being denied. You know, B, it says where the condition on which the land is being held are forthcoming and these conditions provide a transfer to sign an acknowledgement, he must sign it. Fine, I agree to it. C says sanction shall not be given to transferee which involves the subdivision to the set. Believe me, I have cases and I have GLRs where grants have been divided. 108, 108A. So, let's forget these evidences collected from your cantonments. Now, again what I said in CLA rules, you know, page 560 says, but an acknowledgement should not be demanded. But again, it's being demanded. So, you know, this whole chain link has to be kept. And where it started from? Did it start from 1836? No. Pick up sale deeds in 1912 or 1920. You will not find anywhere written that this is a grant under GGO 170. Pick up the grant register. You will have again 15 columns, not 13 the way we have it in our GLR. So all this evidence becomes very important. And this proof can only be done if we are pleading and confirming to this under CPC. That there has been an undue influence, you know, under this section 16. And similarly, we go down to section 111 of the Evidence Act, that proof of good faith in transaction where one party is in relation of active confidence. The presumption of undue influence in uncognizable bargains. In the present, the department is in a position of an uncognizable bargain between the parties of any equal footing. the law raises a presumption of undue influence. It's been upheld in Supreme Court 1963. So the burden will shift to the government. And government does not want that. So an uncognizable bargain is one as no sane man not sitting under a delusion would make. And no honest man would take advantage of. So this is how we need to prove. 19A, power to set aside contract induced by undue influence. This has further been under the Specific Relief Act, Section 30. Court may require parties residing to do equity. The Evidence Act has already been explained under 114G and 1 and 115. So, if we go by all these, we can very clearly come to this conclusion. And that departmental letter which I mentioned of 1930, wouldn't it be discriminately proven that yes, the department does not mutate till we don't sign this admission? So the time frame which is applied under section 81, 346, 354 of Act 2006 and under section similarly 73, 282, 87 or 94 implies for a punishment on transferee for no mutation. No defense state officer under section 4 and 10 of CLA rules is bound to make entries in mutation registers in journal and register. Again, a criminal act has to be, or a criminal case has to be imposed on. But look, we people, you know, we give our admission deeds and we sleep for next 20, 40 years. We don't have the guts to file these criminal cases under this discriminative action on the part of the executive. Now, under Section 73, Transfers of Properties Act 2006, the department must produce the entries of missing sale deeds if admission deeds of your predecessors. This chain link is very important, but does it do that? Otherwise, it goes to prove that admission was taken frivolously under undue influence, collision with a fraudulent motive, and was given by you only as a law-abiding citizen, and has in turn been misused in your case under the right to property given by the Constitution. Now, whether department is supposed to take these admission deeds within cantonment boundary pillars, presuming that all land belongs to the government. Specifically, it clearly says the cantonment is divided in two parts. One is the military boundary pillars and one is the cantonment boundary pillars. So where is this Governor General order being imposed? Whether it is being imposed in cantonment boundary pillars or whether in military. So these kind of provings will only bring us to a point. Once we garner all this, once we are in a position to have knowledge, it's very important, Section 18, misrepresentation. Now, Easement Act 1882, Section 57, grantor's duty to disclose defect. Now, has it done that? No, it has not. Supreme Court upheld it in 1992. So where is misrepresentation quoted under Section 2 subpara? Where a person has entered into a contract after misrepresentation has been made to him otherwise than fraudulently. So these all sections can be read. Contract Act Section 64. Consequences of rescission of voidable contract. Specific Relief Act, Section 30, court may require parties to rescind the doings, iniquity. So there has been a fraud. You know, I'm clearly saying this, that these lands belong to government. They are approving into these admission deeds. They are even asking us to write in these sale deeds. Only then they will do our mutations. So fraud needs to be proved under Section 17. Means includes everything if you go by explanations, if you read the CPCs. So fraud is like tort and the law of jurisprudence. Your claims cannot just be of being an owner of the property, but even of the damages which have been done because of the aid you've been into these grants, old grants, since 1765 or 1793. Or to be more precise, 1855, 1864, and go on till 223. So honorable courts will be forced to understand all this. We've been in possession of these properties. Everybody shouts. I remembered, you know, when we were running these associations and meetings, you know, people used to get up and say, Mr. Das, we've been in possession for 100 years, 80 years, 40 years. So where are these, you know, how, you know, we've been subjected to all this. So we read Article 295, where the definition held has been defined under 295(1)(a). Regarding Article 306, the word held has not been defined in Article 295 or Article 366 of the Constitution, and hence we have to adopt the meaning to the word held in the dictionary. According to the Webster Dictionary, held is technically understood to mean to possess by legal title. If you go by the Black Law Dictionary, it says hold has been defined to mean to possess by a lawful title. So where is all this written? Somewhere it is written, na? That how we go about all this. So we need to really, you know, educate ourselves. Can we do all this? Can we come up with all this? It's not very easy, I know. This admission deed, you know, if you read what is to be done, it's not very easy. We have to understand the laws. Now, where is it written under Rule 6 that we are held by any private person? So that word suffix held is written there. So the department by itself is binding itself into this terminology. So are we holding, or are we held these properties under tenancies, or did we go under something called leases or something called old grants? Everything needs to be proven. So friend, try and jumble up these two videos of mine and actually read into them. It's very easy to counter admission deed. It's not a big deal. But provided we have our records, land records. So I'm once again asking everybody, please dig in your land records. Cut dates are very important. 1938, 1925, 1912, 1899. All sale deeds prior to this. And I bet if you are an old grant, you are a revenue free grant. You are a freehold property. If the government wants to resume your bungalow, it will pay you under Land Acquisition Act or the LAAR 2013. Once again, my request, please follow me on my YouTube channel. Thank you. Good day.